Yeah, thank you all for joining us today. If you are a guest of ours, we have a communication card for you. And if you fill that out, we actually have a gift for you today, a special gift. So you'll actually go out the way you came in. And at the Next Steps table, we have a Christmas gift for you we'd love to give to you. So go ahead and fill out that card. Take it to the Next Steps table. Tonight, we are having a special candlelight service. And so there's going to be hot chocolate. There's going to be some Christmas songs, some candles, and there's going to be a nice Christmas message, so feel free to come and join us tonight. That is at 6 p.m. tonight. And don't forget, before you guys go here, some of you already noticed, we have this really awesome selfie booth in the back, so go ahead, feel free to use that. It'll be here this morning, it'll also be here tonight, that you can go get some pictures, some selfies with your family. There's a little mount there for your phone, so you can get those nice pictures before you go. And as you head out today, some of you might, that are, you know, coming here frequently, we've moved the table for the offering and stuff outside. So if you want to give, that's one way you can do it. You have an envelope at your chair, so you can actually give that way. The offering's just right outside the door before you turn the corner. You can do it online by going to our website, or you can text the number 77977, and you send the message Aspire Church, all one word, to that number 77977, and it'll take you to the same giving portal that way. So that's another way that you can get to that number 77977, and it'll take you to the same giving portal that way. So that's another way that you can give.
Hey, Merry Christmas! Good job. Hey, we are going to have a wonderful time tonight worshiping God. You're welcome to come tonight. We added that service because we just felt like, as a church family, it's Sunday. This is the day we normally worship. At 10:30, if you're a guest of ours, this is where we meet every Sunday, and we celebrate Jesus every Sunday. We celebrate his birth through the resurrection and every Sunday, so you're welcome to join us. But tonight is a special time for us as family to come and to have candles, sing some songs together. If you can make it tonight, we will be here, and we will worship God. It'll be a different little devotion tonight. It'll be different songs tonight. We'll have candles tonight. We're going to sing some traditional songs. So some of you are like, yeah, okay, we didn't sing all my favorites. Maybe tonight we'll sing your favorite songs, all right? And at the end, if we did not sing your favorite, hang out later. I got a pretty good voice. We'll sing your favorite song, okay? I got a pretty good repertoire of Christmas songs. So you name it, we'll do it, all right? If you would, just take out your Bible and turn to one of the most famous, I would say the most famous Christmas passage in Scripture, Luke 2, Luke 2, 8 through 20. We're going to cover the first part of this story tonight, Luke 1 through 7, and then we're going to cover this latter part today. We end our series, Son of God, this morning, and we have our Advent candles lit today, and we talk about really the wonderful hope that we have and the peace that we have in Christ. So today is peace. Boy, thank you for being here last week. Didn't Glenn Elliott do a great job? Did an awesome job last week. If you didn't catch it, please go back and look at it. He talked about this wonderful passage that leads up to this, and we've been going through Luke 1 and 2 over the last few weeks, and just the amazing characters that we see in Scripture, not only Zacharias, Elizabeth, Mary, Joseph, the shepherds, the angel, but also Jesus in the womb and John the Baptist in the womb. And we've been looking through this, and we sometimes skip over John the Baptist in the womb, but he is the forerunner of Jesus, and he comes to announce, and he will announce in the coming years the coming of the Messiah. But really, we see the announcement here in Scripture. And let's read this together. And if you wouldn't mind, let's just all stand and just read this. I'm going to read it, and you just follow along, okay? There were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly a great company of heavenly hosts appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told to them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary, she treasured all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that had heard and they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. Go ahead and be seated. What a powerful and popular passage about the birth of Jesus. We learn in this passage three things. We hear from God how important it is to hear from God. We hear from God himself how important it is to hear from God. And we also learn from this passage that we must make peace with God. And then we also learn that we are to not fear. And I want to just look at the first one for a moment. You see it in verse 20. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. So the first thing I want to talk to you today is about hearing from God. The angel told them something. They heard it, and it was, and then when they went, they saw Mary and Joseph, and it was just as if they had been told this. And they heard this, and they began to spread the word. And so the latter part of this passage, it talks about how they heard, and then they spread the word. What a great example it is for us to hear, and then to spread the word. And this word for the name word is rhema, which means it was a word that they heard, and then it was a personal word that they went and they spread out. So literally, they were not only hearing what the angel said, but then they were spreading the word that literally transformed them. So there is a powerful lesson here that when we come together on a morning like today, Christmas Eve, I can't tell you how many times I've preached this passage and other passages about this Christmas story. And if you're a pastor, sometimes you look at it and you think, okay, how do I tweak this? How do I make it more interesting? The reality is this: you don't have to make this story more interesting. It is the most amazing story ever told. So what I'm going to do is just tell it to you. But in my telling, I just urge you to not just hear it. Because it's easy to show up on a morning like this morning to hear this and then go away unchanged. To move on, to maybe get the last part of your Christmas shopping done, which some of you still need to do, and some of you need to start today, right? So Circle K has great gifts. They have little chocolates you can get, little Reese's. Tradition in my family, I would always go and do some Christmas shopping Christmas Eve to put in the stockings, you know, and all that. And so sometimes I would just gather up stuff from anything that's remaining. And you get some great sales after 9 p.m. tonight, I'm telling you, all right? So some of you are going to go, but in the midst of finishing up your Christmas shopping, getting all this stuff, let's not miss this. This is the message of Christmas. What you're hearing here today is the message of Christmas. And I can't tell you how many times I have seen people give their lives to Jesus on Christmas Eve. Some of you came to know Christ on Christmas Eve. I remember one time we had Christmas Day service. It was a Thursday night church that Jess and I were a part of. It's a college-age church. It was Thursday night. All the college students had left. We thought about maybe canceling it because it was Christmas Day. It landed on Christmas Day, and our services started at 7 p.m. at night on Thursday night. We thought about canceling, and we said, let's not cancel. 40 people showed up, and a family of 20 showed up. So if they had not shown up, how many would there be? Very good. Hey, that's awesome. Great. Good math. 20. They all gave their lives to Christ that night. They heard, but they heard. So we never, ever assume that you know Christ. I never assume that. But I also, on a day like today, it is important for you to know the importance of hearing from God. I believe some of you today may give your lives to Christ. And that would be incredible. That would be worth, band, that would be worth all the practicing of the songs, right? Those that set up, that would be worth all the setting up that we did on Friday, huh? That'd be worth it. So you showed up early and you put the tree out here and you did some stuff here, and it'd be worth it. If the people that were in Aspire Kids are, you know, listening, and they may listen later, it's worth watching the kids in Aspire Kids to do this, because this is the most important thing. And God loves you enough that he left his home in heaven to come and to live on earth, and he cared enough to send an angel to tell a bunch of shepherds this story. And then the shepherds told others. So today, you don't get an angel. I'm not an angel. I may look it, but I'm not. I'm not an angel. You know what I am? I'm a shepherd. The name pastor means shepherd. So you didn't get an angel today, but you get a shepherd. And here's what God has done. Ever since this time, he has given us shepherds to tell you the story, but he has also given us the word of God. So he gives us the word, and it is important for us to listen to the shepherd and to hear the word and to respond to what is told to you. And the first thing is very simple, hear. It's very important to hear. This past month, I did something that I've been waiting since 1989 to do, and the reason I waited is because I just didn't want to be a 30-year-old with hearing aids, or 35 or 40. I don't know if it was too much Van Halen or Metallica. I don't know what it was, but ever since the 80s, I've had a problem with hearing. So this month, I got some hearing aids. I felt so old when I was in there, but you know what? There's a lot of people in this room, a lot younger than me, that have gotten hearing aids. So I got them, and here's the amazing thing. I felt old, and then when he turned them on, I'm like, why in the world did I wait so long to hear? There are a couple of people in my life I just don't hear very much. I don't hear my wife very much, and she would admit, she amen to that, right? And I don't hear my daughter very much, because the high pitch that they have, the higher pitch, not high, but higher pitch that they have, I can't hear. And so sometimes people miss what's being said because they can't hear, right? Well, today, you hear. You hear, there's no excuse. You hear this word. Sometimes people hear, but they don't comprehend. They don't understand. There have been times when my wife will tell me something, and I'll miss it completely, and then I'll miss the appointment, or I'll miss it, and she'll say, I told you. Guys, have you ever done that? Have you just kind of missed it? None of you. None of you are willing to admit it. This is church. Okay, good. You just miss it. She says something, and sometimes we're just not paying attention, right? My oldest daughter, Phoenix, she will sometimes look at me, and she'll say, now, Dad, did you hear what I just said? And she'll know I did not comprehend what she said. Now, I heard just fine, but it just was noise. And she said, I'm going to say it again. And she'll say it. Now today, you're going to hear this again. Matter of fact, you just heard it read again. You've heard this so many times. The question is this. Do you understand it? Do you understand it, and have you comprehended it? And have you applied what you have heard to your heart? Don't miss the beauty and the ordinary way that this story is told. And Mary didn't miss it at all. We see this. She said she treasured it in her heart. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. So the shepherds show up. She's already heard from the angel. Shepherds show up, tell her again, and she pondered these things. She treasured up all these things in her heart. I did a little study on treasured up, because when you hear the word treasure, it's like it's so pretty and it's so neat, and it's like that is so, it just makes the manger scene so perfect, doesn't it? Lighting's perfect. There's little sheep and all that. And then Mary's treasuring up these things. And the Greek word says this. She put into context. She connected what was being said. And she made sense of how I'm to live it out now. So she, when she treasured it, that means that it made sense to her. And she put it into context. And she now is going to walk it out the way that she should live. She kept living out in line with what has been told to her. She doesn't just hear it. She changes her life. Let me ask you, does the Word of God mean something to you? Does, Does this story mean something to you? Does it impact you in a very deep, deep way? Because when they heard this, then they are called to make peace, not only with God, but to others. It says here in verse 13, suddenly a great company of the heavenly hosts appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those," don't miss this, "and on earth peace to those whom his favor rests." I'm going to put this very basic for you. Peace comes to those that have accepted the grace of God. This does not mean that all people receive his peace. Now, his peace is here to receive, but many people do not receive his peace. Would you agree with that? There are many people today that are going to hear this story, maybe even this room, all around the world, they hear this story, but the grace of God does not fall on them in a way that's saving grace. There's a difference between just grace for all of us. Face it, we woke up today, we all have breath in our lungs, we were all able to get here safely, that's God's grace. Being able to show up and wake up and get here, that's grace. Saving grace is when you acknowledge before God that you are separated from him and you need him. And God says, "I come to you and I give you my life. I give you my son." So this passage here is peace to those on whom his favor rests. His favor comes upon, this is very basic, but I have to say it. His favor comes upon his son, only his son. The question is, have you received his son? Does that make sense? So our only hope is whether or not we've received Jesus. There will be a day when we will come before God, all of us will come before God, and he will acknowledge those that know him and those that don't know him. And what he is saying here is, he says, "Depart from me, I never knew you," which means I never knew you through my son Jesus. You know Jesus. So his favor comes to those that have accepted Christ. Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those whom his favor rests. So we make peace with God. There is a peace that comes when we accept God. But then it goes on and it talks about that this word is for all people. Earlier in the passage it talks about this word is for all people, which means it's not just for those of us that have accepted Christ. Now our job, since we've made peace with God, now our job is to go and tell others and be ambassadors of peace, to reconcile others to Christ. So we are also peacemakers, not just peacekeepers, but peacemakers. We are called to actually to share peace with our family. Some of you are going to be going this evening and maybe even tomorrow to family, and it is your job as you walk into that door. Now, some families, maybe kind of like my family, some of you, you have the perfect family. Everything is perfect when you walk in the room. Everybody is leaning to the, you know, one political party and one belief system, and it's all perfect, and everybody feels and believes the same way, right? Right? That's not my family. It's all different. I mean, every year, like, another family secret comes out. It's like, "Whoa, I didn't know that. Wow, you were in prison? I did not know that. Huh? You just got out of prison. Wow, I didn't know that. Huh? Hadn't seen you for a few years." I mean, it's just amazing. All the secrets that come out, that's my family. Now, when you walk in, get this. Since you have made peace with God, here's your job. You've heard God. You've made peace with God. Now it is your job to be a peacemaker. Now, that doesn't mean you try to align them with your political party. That doesn't mean that you try to get them to believe. Your job is to love them, to bring love. When you walk into a room, people say, "Well, it was crazy before you got here, but something happened when you showed up." I mean, you were hugging the kids, you were loving on people. Wow, your favorite football team was on, and you didn't watch that football team. You were in, engaged, and I'm saying that for myself, because tomorrow night the 49ers are playing, and I'll be at Christmas, and I'm going to be engaged with the family, and I'm now preaching to myself right now. Just give me a moment. But I'm going to be engaged with the family. It's not going to be about football. It's going to be about kids and the family and connecting with them, connecting with God and connecting with them. And here's how you do it. If you make peace with God, here's the thing. You're always praying. You're always asking God, continually praying, "How can I bring your peace to this situation?" You're going to be a peacemaker. Not just a peacekeeper, a peacemaker. Peacekeeper is, hey, stop fighting there for a moment until I get out of the room. That's what a peacekeeper is. Peacemaker means I want to bring God's reconciliation to this situation. And then we go on, an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified, but the angel said to them, do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. So who do we go to bring peace? All people. You don't do the saving, God does the saving, but you go to all people. You don't know who's going to accept Christ and who's not, but you go to all people. You go to your family members. You go to people that are at your place of work. You go to your school, and you are peacemakers, making peace. And then three, do not fear. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. Wouldn't you be? Angel of the Lord shows up, and there's these heavenly hosts that show up, and could you imagine to be in that presence of the angels and the heavenly hosts, and they were terrified. The word here for terrified is megaphobic. Megaphobic. Mega means big, great, big. Mega and phobic, scared, terrified. So megaphobic. They were terrified. Are you scared of something? I mean, not a deep thing. Just if you're scared of spiders, bats. You got one? Count of three. We're going to all say what we're scared of. You ready? One, two, three. I heard spiders. I knew we'd get it. Let's try it again. One, two, three. Okay, now you got it. Yeah, you got the idea. We're all scared of something, right? Spiders and bats and all kinds of stuff. But this is a little bit deeper. This is the fear, not just to the brightness of the sky. I believe these shepherds were scared of God. I think there was a reality that I'm before God. I think there is a healthy fear of God. Wouldn't you agree? The holiness of God, the reverence of God. I think when they see this in all its splendor, but then they realize that, wow, God is coming to me. He's coming near to me because he loves me. There's good news that comes. Good news means good news, and God has good news for you. It's bad if God shows up in such a way and it's bad news. But God shows up and it's good news, and they were terrified. Fearing God and his awe and his reverence, that's a good thing. But living in fear, that's another thing. Living in fear is something that's been going on since the very beginning of time. Since the very beginning of time, humans have lived in fear. Very beginning of time. Before Adam and Eve sinned, there was no fear. There was no fear. Sin came into the world, and there was immediate fear. They decided to do things on their own. This is what caused fear. You ready? They decided to be God. At least so they thought. They thought they were God. Never try to be God. How do you try to be God? You say, God, I will live my life the way that I want to live, and I'm not going to hear you. I'm not going to make peace with you. I will do my own thing. And that's what happened. As soon as they decided to separate themselves from God, there was fear. I don't know what your fear is, but they had it then, and we have it now. And the only way to live in peace and to not fear is Jesus. We're afraid of a lot of things. We're afraid of not measuring up. Before sin, they measured up. They measured up as sons and daughters of the King. We're afraid of being alone. Before sin, there was no separation. We had our Father. There's fear of rejection. Before sin, there was no rejection. There was that relationship that they had. When I was 13, I sensed rejection. It wasn't in my family. My family loved me. But I sensed rejection just because I was 13. You ever remember that when you were 13? You just felt like, I'm abnormal, and everybody else is normal. I'd go to school and just felt that way. I had fear. There was fear. My parents moved, and I remember at age 13, I just felt like I didn't know enough people, and I had acne, and my feet were the same size they are now, but I was much shorter. So I had like skis. My feet were real long and didn't look good, and I had crooked teeth. You know, I hadn't had braces yet, so my teeth were all crooked, and I knew I was going to get braces, which made it even worse because I got to have braces and don't know people. And it just felt like I wasn't accepted. And I remember going to camp, and age 13, and I heard a gentleman speak on Jesus' love. And even though I grew up in church my whole life, that did not fill the void of feeling rejected and not loved. Only Jesus could fill that void. And I gave my life to Christ. And it was as simple as me just saying, God, I give you my life. And I gave Jesus my life. And in that moment, now did I all of a sudden stop fearing? No. But there was a beginning point there of understanding what it meant to be loved by God. Can I let you in on a little secret? I'm still struggling with feeling accepted. Sometimes you don't just get over it. Sometimes you feel like, I got to perform, I got to do this, I got to do that, and you struggle with it. But I'm a lot better than I was when I was 13. A lot better when I was 13. And I grew into my feet. You know what? I know that God loves me. He loves me so much, and there's nothing that can separate me from that love. I don't know what your fear is. Maybe it's acceptance. Maybe you're struggling with rejection. Maybe it's you're afraid of the future. You know, it's you have so many commercials that bombard you about the future and how, you know, I've already seen over the last week how everything is going to crash in 2024. Thank you very much. Appreciate that. Yeah. These experts, I wish they were experts in 2008, in 2000, you know? But they don't know when it's going to crash. They don't know what's going to happen. But at the end of the day, whether the stock market crashes or your political system falls apart or the people that you elect or not elect, you know, aren't in power, whatever it is, it doesn't matter because you live in a kingdom that is not connected to this kingdom. The kingdom of God is bigger than that, and you don't need to fear the future. We're afraid of being out of control. Some of you love being in control. As a matter of fact, you're looking at your watch right now because this is throwing you off just a little bit. We're almost done. All right? Some of you, afraid of death. You're afraid of death. Maybe you're like my mom. She, this will be the first Christmas without her this year. And it'd be the first Christmas mom and dad aren't alive. Those times when you think, you know, I could always reach out to mom, call her up, get a card. She suffered from dementia. In the last 4 years, she would send me a card. Sometimes the name would be wrong. Sometimes, it'd be Happy Easter and it's Christmas. It was funny, but at the same time, it was sad. And she passed away this past year. But I'll tell you this. My mom did not fear death. Matter of fact, she wanted to go to be with Jesus. The only thing she remembered at the end wasn't my name. It was hymns. It was songs. I'm going to sing Away in the Manger here in a minute. Boy, she could sing Away in the Manger. That last Christmas that she was alive, I'd sing Christmas songs and she would just finish the Christmas songs. Couldn't remember anything else, but she knew Jesus. And that's all that really matters, right? Didn't fear death. She feared not remembering names. She feared not having everything all together because when you have dementia or Alzheimer's, that causes you to be nervous. But she did not fear death. You know, Jesus fixes everything as far as your fear, your rejection, your fear of death. Your fear of being out of control. Now, whether or not you lean into it and give him everything, that's another thing. Like I said, I still struggle, but the struggle isn't with Jesus. The struggle is with giving him control in those areas. Today is the beginning of maybe you giving God control in these areas. So what's the answer to it? Christmas is the answer to it. Verse 9 says, "And behold, an angel stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid." But it says, "Behold." Behold. Behold means as much as you believe in what is heard. Behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all people." So how can we trust God? How can we lean into God? Really, it's in this word, Lord. Christ the Lord. And the glory of the Lord shone around them. It's the word kyrios. It means king. That's a big word. Don't have time to go into it, but that word Lord was interpreted from the Old Testament to the New Testament. And kyrios means Lord, which means king, Caesar. There were two Caesars on earth at the same time there. You have the Caesar that wants to kill all these babies to get to this one. And then there's this little baby born in a manger, and it's kyrios, which is Lord. There are two lords. And the Lord, when they call Jesus Lord here, from the next few years on, it would cause people to be angry at him and come against him and want him dead. But it also is a word that we cling to in times of struggle. Maybe in times right now where you need to cling to the lordship of Jesus. The baby is God himself. He is Lord. How does God choose to reveal himself? Why does he come this way? Why does he come in a manger? I don't know all the reasons for why he did the things that he did. Born in a manger, going to the cross. We'll talk more about this tonight. But the manger, why would God himself come in a manger? Why would he come to earth? It's the only way that we would actually be able to connect with God. You see, apart from Jesus coming to earth, we would live in fear. We would live distant from God. But he comes to earth and he reveals himself. C.S. Lewis talks about this. He says it's not like we can just go up to the second floor. We're on the first floor. We just go on up to the second floor and say, "Hey, God, how you doing?" Or go up in a spaceship and say, "Wow, God's up here." No, no, no. C.S. Lewis says it's kind of like Hamlet and Shakespeare. Hamlet is a character in Shakespeare's play. And Shakespeare literally, it would be like him having to write himself into the play so that Hamlet would know Shakespeare. The only way for us to understand what's going on is God has written himself into history. He literally had to come down to earth and write himself in to see the love that he gave to us, to see the servanthood that he had, to see a baby born in a manger, to see the humility that was given to us. God writes himself into the story. Christmas is God looking down at the world and writing himself in. That's what Christmas is about. We need saving. We need love. We need acceptance. And Jesus came to give us that. Let's pray. Would you bow your head? Jesus came and he lost his peace so that you could have it. Jesus was killed and rejected, even to the point of not only on the cross, but no room in an inn. There was no room for him to even be born. And he did all that so that we could live with him forever. So that you could have room. Today, as we meditate on this, let me ask you, as you heard the word, have you ever made peace with God? Have you ever given him your life? Have you ever said to him, "Dear God, I turn my life and I give you my life"? If you've never done that, you can do that right now in this moment. Simplicity this moment, just say to him, "Dear God, I trust you as my Lord and as my Savior. God, I trust you as my Lord and my Savior. Just like when I accepted Christ when I was 13, today, God has the power to come in through His Spirit and save you. Prayed that prayer today. I would love to know about it. You can actually take that card and just say, today I trusted Christ. I would love to follow up with you and pray with you. You can even go to the Next Steps table and talk to people about how to follow up. And this is the beginning point, not the ending point. We'd love to talk to you about what it means to be a Christian. Make peace with Him today. As you leave today, not only are you making peace with God, you're going out as ambassadors to make peace to a world that is extremely dark and in need of Christ in you. Go and be the ambassadors God has called you to be. Verse 10 says, but the angel said to them, do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. Sign to you. You'll find a baby wrapped in clothes, lying in a manger. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for coming to earth and showing us what it means to be loved.